Rolling Solo. My name is Adam Smith, and today, as you can easily tell on the game table, we have Chronicles of Drunagor returning as we play through more of what this game has to offer. Now, you'll remember in the not-too-distant past, I gone ahead and put together a start here, or an open-and-play guide video, which was an overview to give you an idea as to how the game plays and flows and operates, but now we're moving past chapter number one. Now, we're going to start by reading off how chapter number one ended. We're also going to go through the camp phase. We're also going to go through gaining some rewards out of chapter number one, and then we're going to head into chapter number two together in a true solo capacity, as we're still controlling just Vorn all by himself. So without further ado, let's go ahead and find out the narrative around the conclusion for chapter number one. The deed done, you return to your frightened and wild-eyed horse. You calm him, but your own mind races. From where did those creatures come? What dark cult would bring the dead back to life so far from the putrid swamps and ruins where they are normally confined? And what is this darkness that they invoke? There is no simple answer, and as twilight approaches, you ride hard for the camp you pass by this morning. Perhaps they will have a clue of what is happening, or at least hot food and a warm fire for the night. The adventure ends here, and now we proceed to the camp phase. You arrive at the place where the camp should be, only to find an empty clearing, the ground torn up by the tracks of carts, animals, and people, all heading towards the road of Umbral. In the center of the clearing, there is only one dusty old tent. As you come closer, an old man in ragged, dirty clothes emerges. Hello, traveler. I'm afraid you've come too late. The camp has broken and the people fled. To Umbral they are headed, and the promise of safety and a way far from all of this. He gestures around at the darkening trees. Darkness has come to these woods, and the people are scared. When he sees the worry in your eyes, the old man smiles. Do not fret, Juliet. This is the woman you saved. She arrived in time. She is on the road with the others and safe for now. There is good in your heart, traveler. You left your path to aid another, and such acts of kindness and mercy make me hopeful and thankful. I have little to offer you but a place to rest for the night so you can continue your quest. Much, I fear, depends on you. Now moving into the reward section of chapter number one, it states to reveal all cards from the level one equipment deck. So I've done that here so you can see every single one of them. In order to find them, they'll have an anvil on the back side. And to know it's level one, well, just a single star. So I have all those items laid out. And at this point, each player, so for me playing true solo, I can choose one equipment card. There are a lot of great choices here to choose from, but I have my eye on one particular card. And that would be the Hidden Blade. I'm really excited for this one because, as you can see, I can use a yellow, red, blue, or green cube in order to do a reaction, as it has the lightning bolt icon for a retaliate, where I can put 3 damage on an attacker. So this could really come in handy after the fact as a reaction to be able to manage enemies, especially if there's multiple of them and I don't have enough of an attack to take it out. This could be the ticket to give me that. And I found during chapter number one, when playing true solo, that there were times I came very close to being able to kill off an enemy, but wasn't able to get as much damage as I wanted to. Well, this certainly would help with that. I've gone ahead and had Vorn equip this weapon in his offhand. So now right underneath of his jagged blade axe, he has a hidden blade, which again, I will definitely be making use of as often as possible. Every time it mentions in the adventure book at the end of one of the scenarios that you're heading back to camp to go through a camp phase, this is what it's referring to. You'll have a reference card here and you're going to follow the steps as it mentions right here on the card from 1 through 6. Now, we technically went ahead and just jumped through these quite quickly as I really went all the way down to the bottom and unlocked my reward because I'd already taken care of 1 through 5 before I even set up chapter 2 and got this on camera for you guys. But I want to go through the different steps really quickly, although you can read them here, as to what you do at the end of a chapter when you're moving into the next one and you happen to be in the camp phase. So the first thing is remove all your conditions and reminder tokens from your hero board, unless stated otherwise, and has examples of all the ones there. Remove all your curse cubes and trauma cubes from your hero board, which I've of course done. Recall all of your action cubes back to your hero art in the center of your board, and you're going to recover all your HP. For my character Vorn, his starting value for health is 12, but he actually has a bump up to 15, so he gets 15 health to go. And then the next one says to erase all status from your campaign log unless stated otherwise. It says started otherwise, but I believe that's just a spelling mistake there, and it says titles are not erased, of course. And then the bottom one is what we just went through, which is to unlock the latest reward. It could be a skill ability, class ability, or equipment. In this case, for me, it was equipment, and write it down on your campaign log if you plan to save things or want to keep track of it. So this ends up being what Vorn looks like going into chapter number 2. You'll also notice he does have 2 focus, and focus does actually stay on your character from one chapter to another. So I get to carry that over, could potentially use it to do a crossed parry in the next one as a reaction if I want to, or to save up more focus and do an actual attack as a hammer crush. So I can decide either way, again, depending on the fact that I need to get some more focus for that second one, but I still have the availability to use the crossed parry. And we weren't able to actually use any kind of focus in the first chapter, but I likely will probably need it in the second one. Now let's read chapter number 2, The Missing from Blackriver, the narrative behind this chapter. Normally, a journey to Blackriver would be a pleasant enough stroll through the shadowy woodlands, but not today. You pick your way carefully past caravans looted and burned, and family farms ravaged and destroyed, always on the lookout for the presence of the darkness. Finally, you reach the outskirts of Blackriver to find the men of the village hastily raising a wooden palisade, their faces marked by fear and sleeplessness. The villagers do not stop to talk to you, sparing only sullen glances and suspicious looks. In search of answers, you seek out the village patriarch. The aged patriarch, dark-eyed and clearly frightened, refuses to see you until you reveal that the Church of the Setting Sun has sent you. You see a glimmer of hope in the man's eyes as he emerges from his hovel. "Sit, sit," his words tumble quickly from his lips. "We are in desperate need. Our people have been going missing in the night without a trace, their homes empty with no sign of robbery or violence. We sent some night guards, but they saw nothing but some strange lights through the trees beyond the long-abandoned fortress of James Ernst. Green lights that would flash in the sky in the fog that seems to drink the light that touches it. Only one of our guards was brave enough to investigate. That was 3 days ago, and we have heard nothing from him. All we can do is try to defend our village and pray to the gods for a succor." He trembles as he speaks. "You are the answer to our prayers, adventurer. Please help us. How could you refuse such an impassioned request? Wasting no time, you set out into the forest, even though the afternoon shadows grow long and menacing. You notice that the villagers continue building their palisade just in case. After an hour, you reach the crumbling pile that was once Ernst's mighty fortress. A cold wind blows through the stones, creating a mournful, haunting howl. The last rays of the setting sun seem to reluctantly shine on that place, and shreds of fog cling jealously to the tumbled stones. The walls show the marks of ancient battles, and you are fortunate to find a crevice large enough to squeeze through and enter the time-haunted ruins. Ahead, you sense a pale, bullish light, and a chill sends tremors down your spine. The sound of running water reaches your ears as your eyes adapt to the dimness. Following the light, you find a stone chamber that has been spared most of the ravages of time. In the wall ahead, you see a stone gargoyle with bright red eyes, flanked by torches in scones. One of them is the source of a strange blue light. A spring pours crystalline waters through a crack in the wall, forming a watery mirror. The gargoyle's presence makes you shudder, or maybe it's something else. You can feel something watching you, lurking in the dark. Vorn has an allotment of 3 movement as well as 2 action cubes to spend his turn. He's going to use his 3 movement to move diagonally and forward north to get adjacent to that point of interest. Using a minor action, he's going to interact with the point of interest. Having spent a minor action, the point of interaction, or as I like to call it, the point of interest, has been ticked from 2 down to 1. The adventure book tells me to go to page 4 of the interactions book, which is what you can see here. And as we've seen in the past, we now have the ability to interact with a number of different things here. We could, at the very top, we could drink water from the fountain. We could pull the red eye stones. We could pick up a scroll, pull the handle. On the far right, we could pull the yellow torch, or on the left, pull the blue torch. I'm going to choose to pull the blue torch on the left-hand side, which is number 4, and it states, as soon as you remove the torch from the bluish flame from the wall, you see the light shine in the corners of the room. In the torchlight, the place looks significantly less dark and oppressive. The next 3 darkness tiles must be placed moving away from the heroes instead of moving towards them, and that's usually the norm, is that it's coming towards the heroes. After that, the darkness will once again chase the heroes. So, this is actually pretty awesome, because we get to buy ourselves a little bit of time where the darkness won't be coming after us. It's worth noting that for that minor action, for doing the point of interaction or interest, you can only do that once per round for that character, so I can't go ahead right now and do another minor action and interact with it again the second time, but I can on the next round do that. So if I stick around that token close enough that I can get to it and do it again, maybe there'll be some other type of benefit, hopefully not a con, that will be thrown at us. And so far, just to remind myself, I've placed translucent die with the number 3 on it in terms of pip value. That's going to help me remember when I'm drawing runes and placing darkness that I've got 3 darkness tiles that are going to be heading away from the hero Vorn and not towards him. Vorn still has 2 action cubes to use, so what I'm going to do is spend my blue one. I'm going to place it down in the bottom right where it states, as an action you may expend 1 AC or action cube to move 3. Just another handy way to gain more movement. This is going to help me to get up against or adjacent to the door so we can try to interact with it as a minor action to open it up, which we're allowed to do during this turn. Vorn's gone ahead and used 1 of his movement to just move north 1 space. He still has 2 left, and he's allowed to spend them after using a minor action like opening a door. So we'll see what the door has for us as we open it and then make a decision for the rest of the movement. The weapon storage. The door opens into what appears to be an old armory. Lit dimly by candles, several weapons lie scattered on the heavy wooden table, along with some scattered scrolls in various states of conservation. A draft pours through an open door, extinguishing the candles on the table. A shiver runs through you, but not from the breeze. As the room grows darker, a terrible chill fills the air. A hooded figure turns towards you at the sound of the door. Even in the gloom, you notice his hard-working hands, too calloused for a sorcerer, perhaps a farmer hands. I've gone ahead and built out the dungeon as it mentioned for that door number 1. For chapter number 2, you can see we now have a bridge that brings us over to another tray full of enemies. We have a rotten flesh in the back left-hand or top left-hand corner there in the blue base, and then a skeleton archer on the right-hand side in the yellow base. Now, the skeleton archer and the rotten flesh are both rookie level at this point. We also have an interaction or point of interaction token at a 2 way up north. We have a new door number 2. There's a treasure chest right beside the skeleton archer. I've placed a black die beside it. That is the trap die. We're going to be rolling that if we happen to try to dig into that chest. And of course, we also have the health for both of those enemies set. We have 6 for the skeleton archer on the yellow band of numbers, and then in the second band worth of blue numbers, it's set at an 8 for the rotten flesh. For those curious how the initiative track has changed, I've gone ahead and found the Skeleton Archer rookie card as well as the Rotten Flesh rookie card. Place them both in the slots based on the runes that are on the very middle of each of the cards. So we've got everything situated. We're still in the middle of Vorn's turn, so we're going to continue it. With my final 2 movement that I had left over, I'm actually going to take a step back 2 spaces. My mindset by doing this is really around the fact that my turn's almost over, which means the Skeleton Archer will be going next, and then the Rotten Flesh. I'm not worried about the Rotten Flesh. It moves quite slowly, but once it gets up close to me, it becomes a serious problem. I might be able to lure it towards the bridge, and then maybe even use those really cool bleed 2 conditions down in the pit below, the spike pit, to push it over the bridge if I have the opportunity to do so, or just to tackle it a little later if I can get around it. But the one I'm really focused on to start, I think, will be the Skeleton Archer. So knowing when it actually activates, it has a movement of 4, and then it has a range of 1. Based on where the archer is right now, it would move to the west 2 positions, and then it would go diagonally down to the bridge, and then 1 more space south down the bridge, and wouldn't be able to target me based on where I currently am, which is perfect. For my final action, and it's worth mentioning, I don't have to spend an action cube here. It's a may. You can choose not to if you don't want to, but I'm going to because I want to bump up how much focus I have overall. I'm going to use a red cube in my battle focus slot. It is going to give me a focus one, which will bump me up to a total of 3 focus, and it cleanses one, which again doesn't help me in this situation, but that's not what I'm using it for. Now, what's awesome about using that action cube in the battle focus area is now I have a total of 3 focus to use, which means sometime down the line when I want to go ahead and trigger my hammer crush, or I could even use the cross to parry if I wanted to, but the hammer crush is really what I'm saving up for. It allows me to do 2 attacks back to back at a +3 hit on each of them and 2 damage if it's a successful hit. That's pretty amazing. That's going to do it for Vorn's turn. We're now moving to the Skeleton Archer, and it's going to activate. The Skeleton Archer is going to have an allotment of 4 movement based on the icon in the bottom left of its card you just saw on the screen moments ago. It's going to use that 4 to try and get as close to me as possible, but it's going to stop the second that it's within range 1 of Vorn. Here's the best part. It can't get to me because I've stepped back far enough. Remember, when you're doing ranged attacks from a Skeleton Archer, specifically it has only ranged attacks, it's looking at the blue squares, and you'll see the bridge itself has a blue square for all 4 of the different spots you could be on the bridge. But if you look adjacent to it, either orthogonal or diagonal, well, there's no Vorn. He cannot attack anybody after using all of his movement. So that's the end for the Skeleton Archer, and that's a great thing for me. He set himself up in a really bad position because now I might be able to make use of the bridge situation and that spike pit below. Next up is the Rotten Flesh to activate. It's going to move 3 based on its allotment in the bottom left hand corner of its card, so it's really just going to head south 3 spaces. So it's on the way, but it's a bit slower, but you can see here they're going to start to kind of cause me a little bit of grief as they sit right on top of the bridge. I also took a look through Vorn's abilities, and unfortunately, even though other heroes inside of Chronicles of Drunagor have the ability to push, or maybe Vorn has these in his ability cards a little bit later on, he doesn't have anything that gives him the ability to do anything that would knock these guys off of the bridge and into that spike pit. So even though that is part of this, the particular character I have doesn't have a skill that allows for me to make use of it, so I really am going to have to take these things on head-on, which is a good thing I stored up that focus as I might need it for that nasty rotten flesh. Now at this point we are going to move to drawing the rune, and it states right here we're going to draw 1 rune and then flip this card. Now remember, I have an advantage from the interactions book that I got where it said the first 3 darkness tiles that come out, they're going to spawn, but they're going to move away from my hero. So I'll be doing my best to do this, although where I'm situated currently might not be the greatest. Digging inside of the bag, we're going to see exactly what we get. We are pulling out 1, and this is the rune we got, and this is the shape. Wow, that is going to be a large one. Well, I can tell you right now, based on all the darkness tiles that are available to me in this game, this is the worst one in terms of how many different spaces it fills with darkness. Plus the fact that, the advantage that I thought I had, well, it really isn't much of an advantage at this point, because this makes the tile I'm on very tough to maneuver around with darkness adjacent to me already. So we're going to have to really, really strategize about how we want to fight these individuals. I might even have to try and attempt to run all the way past them to the opposite side to get away from the darkness that's spawning. But again, also notice there is a darkness spawn position way in the top right hand corner, and you always spawn the tile next to the spawn point, which is closest to your hero. In this case, because I only have Vorn on the board, it makes that really easy, really cut and dry. So I've got a lot to think about now because I didn't expect this at all. I've wrapped all the way around to Vorn's turn at the start of a brand new round here, and we have 3 movement we could use, or we could do some cube actions here. I'm going to use my movement right into the gates here to get adjacent to the archer. With Vorn now in position, I'm going to use a yellow cube, and I've placed it into the guarding strike ability, which gives me 2 shields, and then when I attack, I get a +2 to my hit, and if it's successful on that hit, I get an extra damage. So the guarding strike has given Vorn 2 shields, which will help in defense later on, seeing as he's now on the bridge with the enemies. And we're going to go ahead and do a roll with a +2 for the hit going into it. So knowing that the accuracy on our jaded blade axe is 7, and we already have 2, we need a 5 or higher to have a successful hit here. And of course, a critical success or a natural 20, if we roll that, we get to double the damage of our attack as well as any extra additional damage we have. So if I was to happen to roll a 20 here, which would be crazy, I would actually be able to double the amount of damage. My damage for the axe is 3, it would go to 6, plus the extra damage for the guarding strike would be a 1, and then you double it, which would be 2, so for a total of 8 damage, which would be crazy and wipe it out. Now the chance of me actually rolling a natural 20 here, probably pretty low, but hey, it could still happen. No, 15, still success, but not the best. Overall, I'm still pretty happy with that hit, though. It knocked it from a 6 down to a 2, and I still have the ability to do one more cube action, and maybe that's all I need to take it out. And one correction to mention, which has no gameplay impact, is when you're adjacent to darkness, it actually throws a negative 2 hit at your roll. So essentially, by doing my guarding strike for a plus 2 hit, it kind of nullified that out. So it would have changed the values of what I would have needed to be successful. I would have needed to roll a 7 or higher. Because I rolled a 15, we're A-OK, but it's important to keep an eye on that darkness, because if it is adjacent to you, whether diagonal or orthogonal, it's going to have an impact on your rolls here. I think this next attack is absolutely perfect. I'm going to do what's called Bull Rush. It allows me to move up to 3, and then up to 2 target adjacent enemies are each going to take 2 damage. So not only is that going to kill off the archer, but it's also going to hurt the rotten flesh as well. So with 3 movement that I have, and of course there's nothing stopping me from running way past the bridge and into this other area, but I'd rather make sure I get the damage across both enemies. So let's situate ourselves right in between. Vorn's in position, he does his 2 damage attack against the archer, which will take it out, and 2 damage goes to the rotten flesh, dropping it from 8 to 6. That worked out perfectly to remove one of the enemies, but that's going to end it for Vorn's turn right here, and the initiative marker is now going to move over to the rotten flesh. Looking at the rotten flesh, we have a melee character that's trying to get close to us. It's already adjacent to us, so it's just going to go ahead and do its attack here. It's a cleave 2, but we only have 1 hero in play, so it's not going to try to position itself to hit 2 heroes, because it's never going to happen. And then down below, it has a shadow aura, which is pretty nasty. It will drop a single darkness tile underneath the hero after successful attack, so that's pretty nasty. So we're going to try and see if we can negate this attack. It's 4 damage. I have 2 shields, which I'll spend right now to block 2 of them, and then I think I'm going to use a cube in order to prevent 3. And this is actually going to be really cool, because what I'm going to do is use my yellow cube here in order to prevent the 3. I'll place it in the divert over here. And due to no longer having any cubes available, even though it's not my turn, I use this as a preventative or defensive reaction towards one of the attacks coming to me. So at this point, I'm doing an unwilling recall. All the cubes have been placed back to the middle. It's also worth noting that the 2 shields I had been spent and is gone. And now I have to place a curse cube in one of my ability slots. And just like that, we've prevented the damage coming at us as well as any of the conditions of the enemy. Now, the one thing I was hoping I'd be able to pull off is also to go ahead and use the hidden blade right now to try and do a retaliate 3, but you can only do 1 reaction per triggering event. So anytime you have an attack coming at you, you can only do 1 of the thunderbolt or lightning symbol icon abilities on your player board. You can't do 2, so I couldn't prevent 3 and also retaliate within the same triggering event. Now we move to the end of the round, where we're going to draw 2 runes this time, and again, as I had earlier when I interacted with the point of interaction, I have 2 darkness tiles that will come out, but they'll be moving away from my hero. So digging inside the bag, let's see what we have for runes. The first one is going to be this blue rune here, which will be shaped kind of similar to a C, and the next rune is going to be a green one that looks like this. Now the good news here is that I'm closer to the darkness spawn, which is right here, which means it will be spawning from that location. Of course, it's going to attach itself to the darkness that's already spawned, but it's going to move away, which means it'll be heading south. The first tile fills up the southern area of the map we came from at the beginning of the playthrough, and we still have 1 more tile to lay, which will end up down in that lower region as well. As you can see, the shape we're supposed to place right now doesn't fit down in that bottom right-hand corner, moving away from the heroes, so we're gonna have to break it down into 3 smaller tiles. The 3 tiles have been placed, and you probably noticed that in terms of how far away they are from my hero, they're not getting any further away, which was the overall goal of this, but it's okay. I still place those 3 way back there. I don't have any plans to head back there in that direction. It could be argued that these don't even need to be placed in the end anyway, because they're not moving further away from me based on the bonus I got, but we're going to leave it as is because it's just not going to have any gameplay impact unless I plan on really running away, and then that darkness could have an impact. For now, we're going to be heading north, so no issue. Well, here's the positive. We have this rotten flesh right in front of us now. It's already been hit down to 6, and we get to start Vorn's turn, so we likely should be able to take this thing out on this turn. Looking at how things are laid out currently, I think guarding strike makes perfect sense. It's going to give me 2 shields, going to be a +2 on the hit. I'm not next to any darkness, so I don't take any negative from that, and I get an additional damage, which would jump me from a 3 to a 4 on the attack. It has 6 health. That's pretty decent. So let's go ahead. I put that yellow cube in there. Let's gain 2 shields and make an attack. We're going into this needing a 7, but we already have 2. No darkness effect. So 5 or higher will do it for us. And we... Oh no! That is the worst roll we could have gotten. So not only is this a critical failure as a 1, a natural 1, just like you can have a critical success on a 20, in this case, we're going to take fatigue 1. And what that means is I immediately must go ahead and exhaust one of my AC or action cubes. I'll just go ahead and place the blue one off into one of the sections where there's no cards, just a reminder that that thing has been burned away. The really nasty thing about this is not losing that cube, it's the fact my attack is a complete failure. The game will throw some pretty interesting wrenches in your strategy. Now, I was thinking I'd be able to clean this thing out, no problem, this rotten flesh would be gone during this turn, but that roll threw a wrench into things. Now, I still have focus available that I could spend to make some massive hits against this enemy, and the best case scenario for the hammer crush right here for 3 focus, which I have up top, would be 2 successful hits in a row at a total of 5 damage apiece, which is 10 damage, and that's a lot of damage to put on a 6 damage enemy and potentially waste 4 damage. I'd rather almost save that for a really nasty enemy if there is one to come. Maybe this is the time I should be using it. But what I think I'm going to do instead of that is I'm going to focus on using my hidden blade as a after effect, a reaction later on when it attacks me to kill it off. So what I'll do is focusing on trying to put 3 damage on it, drop it from 6 to 3, and then use my hidden blade to get out the other 3 damage I need. We'll see if that plan works, but as you know, things change quite quickly. So to give myself the best possible chance, I'm going to use the arcing swing, which is a cleave 2, which won't matter in this case, but the +3 to hit is certainly going to help. So now I only need to roll a 4 or higher to be successful. All right, here's hoping that this one goes a lot better than the last roll, because that one was terrible. Okay, a 14, perfect. So that is going to guarantee a hit. And also, it's worth noting here, I do have a passive ability which has not triggered yet. I've gotten super close to it triggering, but it basically is called Tactical Advantage. It says whenever you roll 16 plus, you get to self-shield by 2, which is really nice. I've had a 15 and a 14 now and a 1. So I haven't had the numbers I've really needed, and I think I've had everything else lower than that as well. I haven't had the numbers I needed to be able to get over that. And it's based on the roll itself, not any additional modifiers to it. So as of right now, we did get damage through. So 3 damage is going against this rotten flesh, knocking it down half its health to 3. So currently I'm up against this thing. I'm engaged with it, but I can choose to move away. I do have 3 movement left to spend. I might use one of the movement to actually move back a step on an angle to be adjacent to that interaction, so we can go interact with that weird looking gargoyle statue again, and maybe something of benefit will come out of it as the final interaction. Then I'll have 2 more movement to use afterwards. Again, not really looking for this to be anything that's going to help me strategically, but who knows what might come from that interactions book. For our final interaction here, I still have a number of things I haven't even tried. So you could see coming through this a second time, there'll be other things you can interact with. In this case, there's up to 6 different things. I've only seen 1 of them. So what I'm going to do this time around is do 44 down below, called Pull the Handle. It says, you pull the handle in here with much difficulty deep within the fortress, a sound like stone scraping, as if something small had opened or closed somewhere. That sounds pretty awesome. And it does state right in the book, write down secret lever status on your campaign log. Stuff like that is extremely cool, because you know that there's going to be ripple effects later on in the campaign based on what we just did. Well, we know who's going next, and that is is the Rotten Flesh, and it's going to move to get adjacent to me in order to make its attack, and we're going to have 4 damage coming at us, as well as a Shadow Aura, and we're going to have to think about whether we can prevent all this, or whether we want to prevent all this. The 2 shields that are on me must be used to reduce the damage. You don't get a choice in that. If you have it, you need to use it. So 2 is going to come off the total of 4 damage, so I have 2 damage coming through to me, and I'm actually going to let that damage come through. So that is going to hit me for 2, knocking me from 15 down to 13. It will also place 1 shadow tile based on the Shadow Aura ability underneath of where Vorn is standing. But at this moment, I'm going to then trigger the Hidden Blade with one of my cubes as a retaliate, a trigger action, a reaction, I should say, that's going to do 3 damage to the Rotten Flesh, killing it. And just like that, we're all squared away. The Rotten Flesh has been taken out. It's off the initiative track. We've dropped our health from 15 down to 13. We've also used a red cube to use the Hidden Blade. So I did take some damage, and we do need to now place one of those shadow tiles underneath our character, but that worked out fantastic. So here's the nasty thing. I'm technically caught in darkness. Even though it's not my turn, darkness has shown up underneath of me, and so 2 damage is coming my way. That's the downside of what just happened, and letting that damage come through and not trying to prevent it. But that's okay. I'm all right with taking a couple hits. It's not too bad. We were able to clear out that room. So we are going to drop by 2 unless I can prevent it, which I can. I actually have a divert prevent 3 over here, so I'm going to do that right now. All right, so no damage getting through to me this time around. However, you'll see all my cubes are used, so an unwilling recall action is going to happen, and we're placing another curse cube. There we go, we're all squared away. I chose to put the curse cube in the battle focus position. Again, I have a way to get rid of these. You can see way up here, remove curse will allow me to heal 2 and cleanse 1, which would allow me to get rid of curses. Once you have 6 total curses, well, that's it. You're done. That is the end. So you don't want to build up too many of them. So we move to drawing a rune. This time it will be 1. And the thing to note is that I'm on a darkness tile already. The darkness has already stretched in reach to the strongest hero. There isn't another hero for the darkness to go after at this point. So a tile or tiles won't be laid, but a rune is still drawn and placed. Something else worth noting is you might think that having these runes just sitting on the initiative track doesn't really mean much or have any major impact on the game. But there is an impact, and it's going to come into play with future enemies, and as you progress through the campaign later on, there'll be reference. So pulling the rune out still matters. You still have to do it as the game instructs. I've gone ahead and pulled one out of the bag. I got a blue. Again, we're not going to be placing this tile, as I mentioned earlier before, that we've already had the darkness stretched to the only hero on the game board, and I am sitting on it. So Vorn has done a decent job to this point in keeping most of his health. He's got 13 still. He's taken out quite a few enemies, and he's kept the darkness out of his way. It's behind him. So he's moving towards door number 2 with a point of interaction in the distant future here, right ahead of him. And he's also got a chest sitting in front of him. I'm really curious to see what's inside that chest. So let's use his allotment, starting with his turn right now. He's got 3 movement. Let's use 2 of it to get adjacent to the chest and interact with it. Now, when you do a minor action to interact with a chest and try to search it, you're going to take the token off the game board, which I will do in a second. You're going to go to the treasure deck, shuffle it up, and you're going to pull a card off the top. That will be what you find inside of the treasure chest, but then you have to deal with a trap. Now, every single treasure chest, unless stated, is going to have a trap die associated to it. There's 1 inside the main game box, which you'll roll. There are 4 nasty things that could happen. You could be poisoned, you could be slowed, burned, or you could bleed. And of course, a couple of the sides here are also blank, so there is a chance you'll come out unscathed. So let's go ahead and roll first, and then we'll take a look at what we actually got inside the chest. So let's see if anything nasty is going to happen to us. Oh, it looks like we are going to be poisoned. I've gone ahead and placed a poison 2 token on Vorn. Let's find out what was inside the chest. We'll flip this over. Hey, look at this. We got a potion of fortitude. We can discard this to self cleanse 2. Well, that's going to come in handy for sure. Not bad, not bad at all. I mean, it wasn't the greatest. We got a little bit of poison going on, but we also got the ability to cleanse, and cleansing is really, really handy for getting rid of curses. Not only is a cleanse used to get rid of curse cubes, but in conjunction with a cleanse, you can also remove all your poison. So this is honestly the best time to go ahead and discard this card to do the cleanse, which will remove the 2 poison we just got for opening the chest, plus remove the 2 curses that are currently on Vorn. I have 1 more free movement to use. I'm just gonna move move a little bit closer to that interaction point. That's going to do it for his movement allotment, unless, of course, he wants to burn AC in order to do more movement, which sounds like he's going to have to if he wants to get to the door or that interaction point. So at this point, let's think about how we want to do this. I'm going to use one blue cube on the path of strength. That gives me three movement. I'm going to move once towards the point of interaction, and then with the other two movement, I'll move towards the door most likely. Let's go to the Book of Interactions now to find out what page 5 has for us. In this location, we have a bloody axe, we have a shield, a damaged bow, a crossbow. We could potentially open a drawer and try and examine what's inside of it, examine a scroll, examine a locked drawer, or pick up a sword. So there's a whole bunch of options. Now for Vorn, he's already got an axe, but I really like the look of that bloody axe, so I think I'm going to go with that. In the adventure book, it says, you raise the axe and recognize it as a heavy tribal axe with blood still fresh on the blade. It seems to have been used with great efficiency not long ago. So we take the bloody axe card from the adventure deck at this point. Here's a quick comparison between the two axes that I have. The jagged blade axe that I have right now has an accuracy of 7. This bloody axe still has an accuracy at 7, but you get the benefit now of an ability that says whenever you roll a 16 plus, the attack also gains bleed 2. So that makes the axe on the right, the bloody one, much, much better. And we're certainly, as a minor action, going to equip that. The point of interaction token dropped from a 2 down to a 1. I can only interact with it once on my turn. So that's going to do it, but I have two movement remaining, so I'm going to move two spaces, or maybe just one, over to the door, and we're going to use a minor action to interact with that door right away. The cellar. You enter a long, low room, half flooded with stagnant water. Scattered and destroyed kegs testify that it was once a storeroom for liquids. Trapped in a low area at the far end is a pool of shadow from which tentacles of darkness grope about the walls and floor. Within its featureless whirlpool, a sickly green luminance forms faces hideously contorted with a look of abject horror. A loud slamming sound draws your attention to a pair of figures shambling towards you, their eyes blazing with that of some noisome green radiance. The darkness has given them life, and now they want yours. In the center, we have exactly what we need to set up the next area of the game. And on the right-hand side, something really cool is going to happen because, as you remember, I actually did get the secret lever, and that's the thing I pulled on a prior interaction. So it states here, as a special event, dropped chest. If any hero has a secret lever status on their campaign log, read the following. You see a lever hidden in the corner, and when you pull it, the grating and the creeping stone erupts in the room, and a large wooden chest rises slowly out of the pool of darkness. Replace the event token with a treasure chest token. This is what things look like after going through the last door. We now have another door, number 3, that's available to us at the very tail end. We have a pool of water right in front of Vorn down on the bottom, which is going to reduce his movement as he tries to traverse through it. Then up on the highest platform, we have a Shadow Knight. This is a rookie level Shadow Knight. I'll be placing his card on the initiative track in just a moment. One point of interaction at the very top we can interact with one time, a chest on the lower level. And then on the lowest level, in that pool of darkness down there in the bottom right, thanks to the fact that we had the secret lever on our campaign log based on what we picked as an interaction earlier, this changed from an event token into a treasure chest, which certainly entices me and makes me want to go after it that much more. Now, we're still in the middle of Vorn's turn, but you can see the actual card for the Shadow Knight here, a rookie. It has an immunity to bleed, unfortunately, so that great advantage we have with the Bloody Axe is not going to apply here to this thing. But guess what? It has 10 damage, and guess what I held on to? My focus, which I have the ability to do a pretty powerful ability if I can get close enough to this thing. Two attacks back-to-back at +3 hit each, +2 damage could get me or net me 10 damage total if everything goes right. So I'm really glad I didn't use that earlier on because it's going to come in handy, I hope, very soon. Okay, so there's a lot going through my head right now. I still have one movement left off the movement from my prior action, so I could step down into the water. Now, the -1 move is going to affect that action, but because I run out of movement the moment I actually walk into that space, it's not going to apply at that point. But then I still have one more AC cube to use, which I could use for three more movement. Then at that point, if I'm traversing more so through the water, which I would be, I would then lose a point to movement as I go through. So really that three would turn into a two. I'd already be standing in the water. I could move one more space and then one more after that. So maybe at best I would get to where essentially this label is right here for that level. And that's about as close to this thing as I could possibly get, but unfortunately not close enough to actually make an attack on it. And I wouldn't be able to use my hammer crush just yet, which means I'm gonna have to deal with at least one attack coming from this thing at the bare minimum. This could be a lot worse, it might be two. But what I'd like to do instead of trying to gun to get close to him is I will move the one to get down into the water for the remaining movement that I have, but I think I'm going to use one of my cubes instead to ensure that if I'm going to move or I'm going to do anything else, that I'm also ensuring that I'm getting some shields as well, if that's possible. So I'm going to look to see what abilities I have that can kind of bolster my shields, knowing that its damage is 5 and I can typically prevent 3 as a reaction. Having 2 shields would be perfect. So Vorn used his very last movement from the last action, and now I have 1 AC to spend. Let's find out what that's going to be. Taking a look at my abilities, I do have a whole bunch that allow me to get some extra shields. Like this one here, Defender 2 says join the fray. It's a melee attack, self, shield 2, and move 2, and then go in for a hit. But again, you got to be able to actually pull off the melee attack to be able to make use of that ability in the first place. Now, the things going on inside of it in terms of what's triggering inside of each of these abilities, if there's a semicolon in between them, that's basically separating the actual ability itself that you're resolving, the piece of it, the fraction of it, from the rest of it. So in other words, in this case, you would always get 2 shields and the movement, and then you would do the to hit chance or the attack afterwards, and it's regardless of whether the attack hits or misses, you still get the shields and the movement. But in my case, I still need to be able to get close enough to actually do the attack to be able to use this in the first place, as it's a melee attack. It has the double sword icon there. So I can't just use this just to get shields and movement and then just not do an attack. That's not what that ability is for. Now, I could have done it here with the Whirlwind of Steel. This one here is a self, shield 2, and then it says up to 2 targets that are adjacent to me could take damage if there was any. But I don't have a blue cube to spend there because, well, I've already used it over here, unfortunately. So I'm not going to be able to shield up in the way I wanted to, which means I could take some serious hits here in the upcoming round. So what I'm going to do is just use 1 cube. I'm going to go with another path of strength. I just got to figure out which cube I want to spend. We'll get 3 movement and I'll move as far as I possibly can. In the end, I chose to use a red cube to gain 3 movement. I'm going to go 1 space diagonally to the east. And when I do that, that's going to be 1 point of movement in the water. At that point during that action, I lose another point of movement in there. So I only have 1 more left to spend. I'll use that point of movement to move up on top of that lower level just below where the Shadow Knight is. And that's going to be it for my turn. It is now done, and the initiative marker is going to move to the Shadow Knight, and it's going to activate. We'll talk about all of its abilities right now. The Shadow Knight here has some immunities. The one that matters is the immunity to bleeding, so my Bloody Axe is not going to do as much as it could have against this giant Shadow Knight. The other thing to mention, it's got ranged, and it also has melee. The red icon and the yellow icon let you know that. 10 total health that I have to get through. It has a movement of 2, and it has a damage of 5. Now, the first thing you're going to do is look in the bottom area at the abilities, and if any of them are pinged, you're going to do those right away. In this case, shield 2 is going to activate at the start of his activation. He's going to shield up 2, so we'll do that right now. All right, so he's got his extra shields on there, and next you can see his range is 2. He's got a strike 1 and a knockdown. So the ones that really matter here in this particular instance being that he's going to attack me from range. He's not going to try to get up close to me with melee unless I get up close to him. In this case, he's going to hit me from range, and he's easily going to be able to do that. He's adjacent to me, and he's looking at things in the same way as the smaller enemies would in terms of range, where he's looking at the blue squares, the giant square areas. So he's going to be able to hit me because I'm just 1 away, so easy. So 5 damage is coming, 5 damage is coming towards me right now, and I need to find a way to prevent as much of it as I can. And knowing that I have no shields, well, I'm only going to be able to actually prevent 3 of it at best. So I'm going to go ahead and use 1 of my yellow cubes on my plate armor to prevent 3 of the damage, but 2 damage is coming through, and then we got to check out all of the ability conditions coming at us. So I took that hit, dropping me from 13 down to 11, and we have a strike 1 and a knockdown we need to talk about. Now, a strike is just a type of area of effect that targets a whole area, a whole blue square, instead of just a single target. So basically, when this thing's attacking my hero in this space, it's not attacking my hero, it's attacking the entire blue area. So if any other heroes or anything else that was considered a good guy or a hero in this case was in that blue area, we'd all be getting smashed right now. The other condition on this enemy is knockdown. The affected character receives the token and holds it on their board, and when that character would take its next move effect, either its own move action or a skill, it loses that action, and then you remove the token from the board. So it kind of slows me down. I've added a knockdown token onto Vorn. It's important to note I've also knocked him over on the game board in terms of his miniature, just to remind me that I'm going to burn the first bit of movement that I get here. But now we're going to move the initiative marker from the Shadow Knight, and we're going to deal with runes. So we are now going to move to drawing a rune, and there's one correction I want to make. I did not flip the card over after resolving the last rune last time. No gameplay impact whatsoever. It just should be on the opposite side, which means we're going to be drawing two runes this time. So digging into the rune bank, let's grab two. And just to make a note here, we're on a totally different platform now, so there's a darkness spawn area very close to where I am, which I'm not looking forward to seeing what's coming my way here. So a blue one out of the bag, and it's a small one, so that's good. A little tiny corner piece, I'm all right with that. And then we're gonna go into the bag, grab the next one. The second one will be, oh, that's much larger and much more dangerous for me. So here is Vorn currently laying over, knocked down, and we're going to place darkness starting from the spawn point in the bottom right with the very first rune you saw, which was the corner piece. Here's how the very first piece laid down looks like. It's already creeping its way over. And just to make things even more insane for me, I am completely surrounded by darkness. Now at this point, I'm actually not in a darkness space, which is pretty amazing based on the way the pattern ended up and where I ended up moving. So I'm safe for now, but again, darkness is going to hurt me to my hit value as I'm trying to make attacks, or it's going to, of course, benefit the enemies by me being surrounded by darkness or potentially running onto it at some point and taking some serious damage. So everything was going to plan until it wasn't, and that's what will happen in Chronicles of Drunagor. Things will be going to plan, and then everything will go sideways on you, and you're going to have to change up your strategy to try to take down the enemies. And I've got a lot going for me now, but I've got a lot going against me with the darkness completely surrounding me. I've been knocked down, so I'm laying over right now, which is going to burn some of my movement coming up on my next turn in the next video. And I've got this huge Shadow Knight at full 10 damage ready to come at me some more. So I'm really hoping keeping the focus on using my focus from the Hammer Crush ability that I'm hoping to pull off here will be what I need to get past this individual as quickly as possible. But we'll see how that pans out in the next video. Really hope you guys will join me for that. And let me know in the comments below, what would you do in this situation to try to take down the Shadow Knight? I cannot wait to hear what you guys have to say. Thank you guys so much for watching. And as always, keep on rolling solo.